announcement. Last week, many of our friends informed us that there is a conflict between physics course and chemistry course. So I decided that I finished the course at 2:30. So it means that we will have 90 minutes in the course. And as far as I learned, your chemistry instructor will start 30 minutes late. So by doing this, we prevent this conflict. Okay. Today you will learn in details from chemistry course. In physics part, I can do only this one. Okay. And today, let us start our topic. Let me look at our recording. Okay, we are recording. As I told you before, I follow this book. Here, the PowerPoint comes from the University Physics. Okay. There are okay, so should I talk? So what about now? I'm talking loudly. Okay, let me talk. The system tells me that my voice is clear. Okay. Okay. Let us start the lectures. Here, as I told you before, I use this University Physics book, Pearson's. Okay, the presentations come from that book. Okay. Now, let us start with topic. Let me skip some slides. Okay. Obviously, to express something, we make some measurement, okay? And after the measurement, obviously we express the result, measurement result, with some numbers and with some units. So this combination of number and units are called physical quantity, okay? So a physical quantity is expressed by a number and unit. So it means that it is just result of measurement or result of calculation. But if you talk about a physical quantity, you must express it by just a number and unit. Okay, the simplest example is length. It's a physical quantity because when you measure the length of table, for example, you see a number on the ruler and you express the result by a unit. You can use centimeter, for example. When you measure the length of the table, let's say you found 125 centimeters. So it has some number and it has some unit. And in fact, the meaningful part is unit. It tells us the type of the measurement, what you measure. Okay. So when you say centimeter, we can understand that you measure the length of something. Okay. Without saying unit, we cannot understand the measured quantity, what you measure or what you did. Okay. And basically, there are two types of physical quantities. These are fundamental quantities and derived quantities. In our course, basically, we use length, time, and mass as three fundamental quantities. And these fundamental units are determined by some unit systems, and most common unit system is called SI unit system. Okay, in SI unit system, length is measured in meter, mass in kilogram, and time in seconds. Sometimes we call this one as MKS system, which comes from the initials. Here, look at the initials. M comes from meter, K comes kilogram, and S comes seconds. So that's why we call this system as MKS system. So maybe it will make you more comfortable to memorize this one. When I say MKS system, you can say that length is meter, mass is kilogram, and time is second. Obviously, it depends on the definition. You can construct many unit systems, but the key idea is the unit system must be practical, it must be easy to use, and it must be valid for everyone or everywhere. So you can determine some other unit systems, and the secondly common unit system is called CGS units. And in that unit system, it's obvious that the length is measured in centimeter, mass is measured in gram, and time is measured in seconds. So in our course, basically we use these two unit systems. But you should be careful about that. If you use one unit system, you must strictly follow that system. How can I say? For example, in a problem, I give you the length in centimeter and mass in kilogram. So the measurement tells us we have two unit systems. Okay. Centimeter means that we use CGS unit system. Kilogram means that we use SI unit system. So we should select one unit system and continue our calculations, follow our calculations in that unit system. Okay. If the given quantities are the members of different unit systems, you should select one of them and continue by using that specific one. Okay. Okay, I told you that the units The physical quantities are derived quantities and fundamental quantities, or sometimes we call that base quantities. Okay. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 fundamental quantities. And the other physical quantities are derived from these. Okay. Length is one of the fundamental quantity. Mass, time, electric current, temperature, amount of substance. You will learn in chemistry. Maybe when you see the unit, you can remember it. And luminous intensity, it is related with the brightness of a bulb, etc. Okay. So we have 7 base quantities, and in SI unit system, their units are these. As I told you before, in our course, we concentrate on these 3 fundamental quantities. Okay. Until now, do you have any question? This is very simple. You just memorize these units, and in fact, I believe that you already know this one. What are the derived physical quantities? Obviously, you can derive many physical quantities by using the combinations of base quantities, but to give some idea, let me put some examples. Area, volume, speed or velocity, density, etc. These are the derived units. Here, when you look at the symbol, for example, let us look at speed. What is it? It is meter per second. Meter is one of the physical quantity. It refers to length, right? Length per time. So this is length per time. So a fundamental physical quantity here and another fundamental physical quantity. So we derive the velocity from these two fundamental quantities. And that's why we call it derived quantity. And the unit of it is derived unit, which is m over s. You can increase the number of examples, and sometimes you can call specific names these derived units. For example, joule. This is the unit of energy, and it's a derived unit. But in a SI unit system, we have a specific name, it's joule. Okay. If everything is clear, let me skip the next part. Let me start the next part. Again, I have to say that you should be careful about the units. Okay. You shouldn't use different units in one question, one example, or in one case. Okay. You should select a unit, and you must follow that unit system. This is important. Now, let me return the definition of the physical quantity here. We have a number and a unit when we want to express a physical quantity, we must have these two. And we learned something about unit. Now let us look at the number. Obviously, I will not talk about the types of numbers, rational, irrational, etc. I will just talk about the expression of the numbers. For example, we make some measurements and we have some numbers. They may be very large or they may be very small. So instead of writing many zeros, we express the numbers by using some specific prefixes. Okay. For example, if I have 10 to minus 6 meter, instead of writing this one, I can write 1 micrometer. Okay. This strange symbol is called micro. In fact, I will have a table I will share with you. Okay, so to express the large or small numbers, we can use some specific prefixes. Okay, each prefix refers to some certain number. This is something like that. For example, let me try to find an example. Okay. Here, when I say a centimeter, 1 centimeter, I mean that it is 10 to minus 2 meter. Okay. 1 millimeter, remember that, 1 millimeter means that it is 10 to minus 3 meter. So you can express the numbers without writing them as powers of 10. Okay. And in fact, we are already using these prefixes in our daily life. For example, when we say that our computer has 2 terabyte hard disk, it means that we have 2 × 10^12 bytes here. Or you can about the yes you can talk about the RAM. So it is, for example, 8 gigabyte RAM. What does this mean? It means that you have 8 × 10^9 bytes. Okay, so you are already using these prefixes in our life. So when you try to memorize them, it will be very easy. In our course, basically we use this part. Okay. So when I say the radius of atom is 1 picometer, it means that 10 to minus 12 meters. So instead of writing this one, I just say pico. Okay. But I believe that since you are familiar with these prefixes, it will be very easy to memorize just only these two prefixes. Nano, you already know nano robots, nanotechnology, etc. So it means that the devices is around this scale. Okay. So, do you have any question about the prefixes? Okay. So. We are clear in the numbers. We can do our calculations by just writing them in power of 10 notation, and it makes the calculations in very clear. Now the next thing. As I told you before, we have many unit systems. Okay, we can construct a unit system just it must be useful and it must be universal. And in our course, as I told you before, in our course we just use two fundamental unit systems, SI and CGS. But we must convert one unit system to another unit system. So, how can we this one? It is just done by a simple rule, chain link conversion rule. In this chain link conversion rule, we just multiply the original measurement by some conversion factor. And this conversion factor is just a unity. Now let me explain what I mean in the example. Okay, I skipped that part. You can read this one. I put the presentation on the web, so you can read it. So, for example, we have 3 minutes, but you know that in SI unit, both SI and CGS units, the unit of time is seconds. So you need to convert this time measurement to the second. So how can we convert this one? We just multiply the original measurement by some conversion factor. Okay. What is our conversion factor? This is our, oops, sorry. Let me use my, okay. This is our conversion factor. Okay. And you can construct this conversion factor. Here, this is the ratio of times in different units, but they must refer the same time interval. Okay, you know that 60 seconds is a time interval and it is equal to 1 minute. It is the same time interval. So the ratio is equal to unity. And How can we decide that which one is in denominator? Here we have original measurement in minutes, and I want to convert this one to the second. So I want to get rid of minute term. It means that in the conversion factor, minute term must be in the denominator that we can cancel the original measurement. So the original unit is canceled by this one, and the rest is second. Then you can convert this 3 minute to the 60 second, 3 minute to the 180 second. So this is a simple example, but let us look at another complex example. The world land speed record of 863 miles per hour was set, blah, 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 blah. This is not important for our problem. Express this speed in meters per second. Okay, it is just a unit conversion question. The length is given as miles. Okay, you should convert to meter, and time is given as hour. You should convert it to second. So you should do the conversion step by step. You multiply the original measurement by some conversion factors. First of all, we know the relationship between miles to kilometer. Then we know the relationship between kilometer to meter. Since we want to get rid of miles term, mile must be in denominator, and we know that 1 mile is equal to 1.6 kilometer. So mile terms are gone. We have kilometer term. But the question is about meter, so you should convert kilometer to meter. To get rid of the kilometer, you put 1 kilometer to denominator. They are gone. So length term is converted. What about the time term? We know that 1 hour is just 3600 seconds. By using this relationship, you can convert the time from hour to second. I skipped the calculation. In every stage of the course, you can use your calculator. So you can do the calculation by using calculator, and the result is approximately 341 meters per second. Okay, now let me look at the other subject. We have one more example, but I'll skip it. Let us talk about this one. What is it? This is scientific notation. I told you before that we express the very large and very small numbers by using some specific prefixes, but when you look at the prefix table here, they show only some certain powers of tens. Here we have 10 to 6, 10 to 9, or 10 to minus 12, etc. What about 10 to 7? Obviously, we don't have any prefix, so we just write them as in this notation. And this is called as scientific notation. Well, it is not so complex. So it is very easy to write the huge numbers as powers of 10. Example, speed of light. Instead of writing, you know that speed of light is approximately 300 million meter per second. So instead of writing these plenty of zeros, we may express the number as powers of 10. Because in that case, we may miss one of the numbers, one of the zeros. And obviously, it makes very huge mistake. It gives us very huge mistake. And remember that energy formula, very famous energy formula, E equals to mc square. So when we try to take the square of the speed of light, what happens when we take the square of the speed of light? We have 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. This is the c square. It is very hard to read this one. It is very hard to write this one. And instead of doing this, well, in fact, I didn't do anything. Okay. So let me repeat myself with these numbers. I concentrate on the speed of light example. Here, the speed of light is just 3 million meter per second. Instead of writing scientific expression, scientific notation, if we try to write it, you will see that there are plenty of zeros and you may miss one of the zeros. Or in the calculations, we cannot skip c. For example, we just take mc square to find energy. And what about the c square? It is this one. Oops, where is it? Anyway, it is this one. So you have plenty of zeros, you miss one or two zeros, or when you try to read this one, you cannot read it properly, etc. So to prevent these difficulties, we just express our very huge or very small numbers as powers of 10. So it is 3 times 10 to 8 meter per second. This is the speed of light. And when you take the square, it is very simple. It is just 9 times 10 to 16. When you take the square, remember that you just take the square of number and just multiply by 2 this power. Okay. What else? We have some significant figures or rounding off rules. This is the answer of the question: how can we make rounding off, and how can we how many digits that we use in our calculations, or how many digits that we write in our results. So, in fact, you must follow the definitions which are given in these presentations. For multiplication and division, the answer can have no more significant figures than the smallest number of significant figures in the factors. Okay, I will explain them with some examples, but I put just definitions in some specific place. For addition and subtraction, the number of significant figures is determined by the term having the fewest digit to the right of the decimal point. Okay, these are the definitions. But the example is much more instructive. Okay, first of all, in the multiplication or division case, we may have this combination of numbers. You can ask me that why we have different decimals. In the beginning of the today's lecture, I say that we make some measurements. Okay, and when we make some measurements, obviously we read the result from the device. And the important thing is the precision of the device. If the precision of the device is big, you can read more decimals. Okay. So .0.745, the measurement device can make some measurement to give three decimals. Okay. But you make another measurement by using another measurement device, and this is not so precise as this one. Okay. That's why we can have some different decimals. So, let us look at how can we express our result. The result can have no more significant figures than the factor with the fewest significant figure. Okay, what is the fewest significant figure? This one. We have one, two digits. What about this one? We have three digits. One, two, three, four digits. So the result must have two digits. 0.42. Here in the result, you have two. What about this? The fewest significant figure here. Three digits. Okay. So after the multiplication, you can write the result with three digits. Is it clear now? Yes, I said two digits for this previous example. For this example, let me erase everything and explain myself one more time. Let me talk. Okay, if you understand it, okay. Okay, now what about the addition and subtraction case? In this case, we look at the term with the largest uncertainty. What does this mean, largest uncertainty? It means that the measurement is not precise as the others. Here you have one decimal. Here you have one decimal, you have two decimal, and you have three decimal. The fewest digit is this one. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4 digits. And after the decimal, you have only one digit. Okay, is it clear? Okay. Now this question is about the rounding off. Yes. Okay, I skipped the definition because we talk about MC square. Okay. Now C is given in the question. M is also given in the question. Okay. Find the energy to three significant figures. Okay. In fact, if this one is not given in the question, you can find the number of significant figures from here. We have three significant figures. Remember that after the multiplication, the factor with the fewest significant figure must be in our number of figures for the result. Now we just perform the multiplication, we get this result. And since it says three significant figure, What happens? You have one number and two decimals, right? So 8.19. Okay, since this one is greater than the 5 here, you just run to one more digit, one more number, which is 9. Okay, so this is 8.19 times 10 to minus 14 joule. This is the result with three significant figures here, 1, 2, 3 significant figures. Okay, if it is clear, let us talk about the vectors. Here we have two quantities, scalar quantity and vector quantity. Scalar quantity is just a number, but vector quantity is number. Vector quantity contains a number and a direction. Okay. In this book, a vector quantity is represented in boldface italic, blah, blah, blah. Okay, we use the same agreement letter and arrow over it represents a vector. Okay. And the magnitude of the vector is represented by this one. We use this one in our lectures. Okay. So a vector quantity must contain a number and a direction. And you can express the vector by drawing it . The length of the line is the vector's magnitude, and the direction of the line shows the vector's direction. So let's say you are moving from one place to another place. Okay, let's say you are moving from P1 to P2. You just draw an arrow, and this arrow represents a vector. So when you change the direction of arrow, obviously you just change, take the opposite of the vector. You can perform some algebraic operations on vectors. You can add the vectors, you can subtract the vectors, you can multiply the vector by a number, and you can multiply the vectors by scalar product and by vector product. So we will see these operations on the vectors. And we will learn how to express vectors. First, if we can express the vectors as arrows, okay, you can add these two vectors by just putting the tail of the second vector to the head of the first vector. And this one is called as graphical addition of vectors. Okay. And you can change the order. A plus B equals to B plus A. The order doesn't matter in the vector addition. And also we can add the vectors by using parallelogram. Quick in this graphical part because instead of graphical part I prefer to use the unit vector case because it will be much more simpler. Only vectors A and B are parallel. The magnitude of their vector sum C equal to sum of their magnitudes. C equals to A plus B. Okay. So what happens when we have more than two vectors? First of all, we just add these two to get another vector. Then we just add remainings. Okay. So in other words, you can perform the addition by grouping them two by two as one method. As another method, since vectors can be added in any order, you can use the head to tail method. So you put one vector to other vectors head, etc. So by using this new configuration, you can find the total vector. In the subtraction case, you just change the direction of the vector. Okay. You can see from these figures. And you can multiply the vector by a scalar. It means that it just changed the magnitude of the vector. So the direction of the vector does not change when we multiply it by a scalar. Let's say our vector is A and we just take twice of it, so it makes just 2A. The direction does not change. Only the magnitude is changed. But obviously, if we multiply the vector by a negative number, for the negative number, you can just change the direction. Now, this geometrical representation of the vector could be difficult because you need to use some trigonometrical expressions, some trigonometric properties, etc. Instead of doing this, instead of using this geometrical interpretation, we use the unit vector notation to construct the vector. How can we do that? First of all, we determine the components of the vector. Okay. Let's say our vector is A. We know it. We can find the component of it. It is just a projection on x-axis is the x component of the vector, which is a times cosine theta. And y component of the vector is just a sine theta. These are the components of the vectors. Is it finished or do you want to continue to talk about some other stuff? If it is finished, I can go further. Or if you want to talk, let me finish the course. Okay. Okay, you can calculate the components of the vectors and you can find the magnitude of the vector from these components. And also you can express the direction of the vector by expressing this angle theta. But how can you do that? If you know the components of the vector, you can construct the magnitude of the vector and you can determine the direction. Here, the magnitude of the vector is ax squared plus ay squared. Okay. And the direction can be determined by this angle because tangent theta is ay over ax. Let me return our triangle here from triangle. You will see that the tangent theta is ay over ax. And from this expression, by taking the arctangent, you can determine the theta. So this configuration, this expression of the vector is called magnitude angle notation of the vector. Okay. Now, as I told you before, this geometrical expression of the vector could be difficult. Instead of doing that, we use unit vector notation. First, what is a unit vector? Let me determine it. A unit vector is a vector with magnitude of 1, okay, and it represents, it points only one direction. If you are talking about positive x direction, the unit vector is I hat. For positive y axis, the unit vector is j hat, and k hat represents the positive z direction. So you can construct the vector by using unit vectors and the components. So A vector equals to ax I hat plus ay j hat plus az k hat. Okay. Let us compare with the geometrical case. Here this is the geometrical expression A. Okay. What are the components? The x component is ax I and y component is ay j. Okay. For example, we have two displacement vectors, d and e, and the question is about finding these magnitude of this vector. Yes, what is the question? Okay, I, J, and K are unit vectors. Okay, let me explain one more time. I, J, and K are the unit vectors. Their magnitudes are 1, okay, and they represent only one direction. This is the definition of unit vector. And I points, or I is directed on the positive x-axis, let's say this is the positive x-axis, okay, so I points the positive x-axis. For J, this is J, okay, because this is y-axis, and J hat points the positive positive y-axis. So this is the J hat. This is for positive x-axis. This one is for positive y-axis, okay. And what about the positive z-axis? Okay, it will be a bad expression, but I try to put it something like this. Let's say this is the positive z-axis, okay. For the positive z-axis, the unit vector which points the positive z-axis is this one, and this is k hat. Okay. So for I couldn't put hat in the keyboard, so I just write I, but you should know that it is I hat. Okay. J, where is J? I don't know. For this one, this is K. Anyway, if it is clear, let me continue. Okay, D and E are given vectors here, and find the magnitude of this vector. It is very clear and easy. You just multiply D by 2, okay, and perform a subtraction with E. Here you can do the operation component by component. Here I had refers x component, so you can subtract these two. You can subtract these two, and you can subtract these two. Okay. You can You must perform the operation component by component. So for the x component, 2 times 6 is 12. 12 minus 4. I had it. It means that, remember that, x component of the vector. 2 times 3 is 6. Minus minus gives us plus 6 plus 5. Okay. And 2 times 1 is 2. Minus 8. Blah blah. You can do the following multiplication, subtraction. And what is it? This is the, let me take blue. This is the x component of the vector. This one is the y component of the vector because of j hat, you know. And what is the z component of the vector? It is this one. This is the z component of the vector. So how can you find the magnitude of the vector? You just take the square of the components, add them, and take the square root. So F is, the magnitude of the force is this one. Is it clear? Now, let us look at the product of two vectors or multiplication of two vectors. There are two types of the multiplication. The first one is called scalar product, and another one is the vector product. In the scalar product, the result is just a number. And for the vector product, the result is another vector. Now, let me write the expression of the scalar product, which is this one. This one is the scalar product of two vectors. This dot represents the type of the multiplication. If you see this symbol, it means that the operation is the scalar product of vectors, and the result must be scalar. So it means that the result must be a number. Let me write here. I think I used the one. The result must be number, or usually we use it as scalar. Okay, that's why we call this one. It doesn't matter. I just say that the result must be scalar. Okay. So A dot B equals to AB cosine phi. Remember, AB means that the magnitude of the vectors, okay, the magnitude of A, the magnitude of B, cosine phi. What is phi? Phi is the angle between these two vectors. To find the angles, obviously, you must put the vectors tail to tail. So if they are parallel to each other, the vectors, if the vectors parallel to each other, phi is zero, and the result has its own
maximum. Because remember that the cosine phi can take values from minus 1 to plus 1. So plus 1 case is the maximum value. And it is possible when only phi equals to 0. And when the vectors are perpendicular to each other, obviously the result is 0. So these are two limiting cases. The important one is phi, if phi is 90 degree, the multiplication is 0. Okay. But you want to perform this scalar product, but you don't know the angle between these two vectors. You just know the components of the vector. How can we perform the scalar product? In fact, it is very easy. If you know the components of the vector, you just perform the scalar product by using this rule, this formula. Okay. And with the help of the scalar product, you can determine the angle between these two vectors. Yes, x component of the vector A. Okay, for example, find the scalar product of two vectors given in the figure, and the magnitudes of the vectors are 4 and 5. Now, the angle between x-axis is given as 53 degree. Okay. For B, it is given as 130 degree. But remember that in the scalar product, you need to know the angle between these two vectors, phi. So, how can we determine phi? It is very simple. You just take the difference of these two angles, which is 77 degree. So A is given, B is given. You found the angle between these two angles, and you put everything in the equation, and you can get that A dot B equals to 4.5. Okay, the next thing, if it is clear, let's say somehow we know the result of scalar product, but we don't know the angle. So how can we determine the angle between these two vectors? It is very simple. Here, if you know A dot B and magnitudes of the vector, you can find the angle between these two vectors. We have one equation and one unknown. You just solve a simple expression. Let's say we have two vectors and we don't know the angle between these two. How can we find it? Remember the expression. A dot b equals to magnitude of a, magnitude of b times cosine phi. So you can find an expression for cosine phi. It is a dot b divided by ab. A dot b divided by ab. How can you find a dot b? Remember that if you know the components of the vectors, you can use this formula. If you know the components of the vectors, you can use this formula. Okay, let us go step by step. The scalar product of these two vectors is minus 3. And what are the magnitudes of vectors A and B? The magnitude of vector A is square root 14 and magnitude of B is square root 21. So cosine phi is, after the calculation, cosine phi is minus this one. Phi is 100 degree. Do you have any question about this example? Okay. Now, as I told you before, we have two multiplications on the vectors, scalar product and vector product. We learned the scalar product. The multiplication of the vectors gives us a number. In the vector product, you can understand from the name, the result is just another vector. And sometimes we call it as cross product because we use this cross symbol. So if you have two vectors, the vector product of two vectors gives us another vector. And the magnitude of the vector product can be calculated by using this formula. C equals to A B sine phi. Okay. And we said that the multiplication, the vector product gives us the third vector. How can we determine the third vector? We use the right-hand rule. To use the right-hand rule, first of all, you should put A and B tail to tail. Okay. Then you point your four fingers parallel to A. Then curl them to the B. Tom will give you the direction of the resulting vector. So from right-hand rule, as you can understand that, the order is important. A cross B is not equal to B cross A. They opposite to each other. Because in A cross B, you curl your four fingers to B. But in B cross A, you curl your four fingers to A. So they have different directions. But how can we find the vector? Okay, we say that there is a resulting vector which is perpendicular to these two vectors,
here as you see from the figure. But how can you construct it? In order to do that, you should use these equalities in the vector product. I cross I, J cross J, K cross K equals to zero. So the same components gives us zero. Okay, the purpose of the right-hand rule is just to determine the direction of the third vector here. In the vector product, you have another vector, right? The purpose of the right-hand rule is just determining the direction of the C. How can we do that? First of all, A and B must be placed tail to tail. Okay. Then for A cross B, you put your four fingers parallel to A. Then curl, you must curl your four fingers to B. Okay. Let me try to draw it. Your four fingers are parallel to there, to A. Then you curl your four fingers to B. Okay, you curl four fingers to B. When you curl four fingers, obviously they are closed and the thumb will give you a direction. The thumb points just the direction of the resulting vector C. Is it okay now? To construct the vector C, you must use these equalities. Parallel components gives us zero, and perpendicular components have some relationship. I cross J equals to K, J cross K equals to I, etc. So from here, when you write the components of the resulting vector, Cx, Cy, and Cz, you can find this expression. Okay. I skip how to construct. You may just memorize this one. Do you have any question? If it is clear, let me try to solve a question, an example. Okay, this is the example. We have a vector A on x-axis, and it has magnitude 6. B has magnitude 4, and the angle between A and B is 30 degree. Find the vector product. Okay. Now the magnitude of C
is found by the formula C equals to AB sine phi. Here, this one. AB sine phi. In the question, A and B are given, and angle phi is also given as 30 degree here. So the magnitude of the vector, the magnitude is 12. Okay. So from right-hand rule, A is in parallel z-axis, parallel to x-axis, and you curl your four fingers to B. Oops, where is my pen? Okay, so you curl four fingers from A to B. Then you will see that when you curl your four fingers from A to B, the thumb will give you the z-axis. So, by geometrically, you can construct the vector as 12 k-hat. Or you can use this formula, Cx equals to this one, Cy equals to that one, and Cz equals to that one. So there is no y and z components of the vector A because it is lying on x-axis. So there is no x component. What about the y component of the vector? It is zero because az is zero and bz is zero. What about the z component? Here you see that there is no z component of b and z component of a. So you have what? Ax, by. This is the only surviving term. So when you do the calculation, Cz is 12 and C vector is just 12 k hat. How can we write k hat? Because we have only z component and z component refers k hat. So that's it. Is it clear? Okay. Now first, let us determine the components of the vectors ax, ay, az. Remember that in the question, vector A is on x-axis. So there is no y and z components. Okay. So ay equals to 0, az equals to 0. Ax equals to 6. And what are the b vector? What are the components of the b vector? When you look at the figure, you will see that there is here x component and y component of the vectors. The x component of the vector is just b times cosine 30, and y component of the vector is just b times sine 30. When you do the calculation, bx and by can be easily found. And obviously there is no z component. Now we calculated the components of the vectors. Now let us try to calculate the components of the resulting vector. What is it? Let's say Cx. This is the formula for the components of the resulting vector. Cx equals to this one. Ay bz minus az by. But you know that this one is zero and this one is zero. So this is zero. What about cy? Remember that z component of the vector A is zero. And z component of the vector B is also zero. So this is zero, this is zero. So this is the result is zero. The z component ax by minus ay bz. Remember that in the question this one is zero. There is no y component. The only surviving term is this one. What is it? Ax is 6. Ax is 6. And by is 2, which is 12. So z component of the resulting vector is 12. Okay, Cz is 12. Okay. In the z-axis, you have unit vector k hat. So the vector, C vector, is just 12 k hat. Okay, if it is clear, let me stop here. Okay. So if there is no other question, yes, you can. In fact, I stop here. So you can go to chemistry. Okay. Have a nice day.